everybody. Go ahead and be seated. Good morning. Welcome to City Church and Merry Christmas. My name's Luther. I'm one of the pastors here at City Church, and we're so glad that you're here. We are celebrating Advent. We actually began a week early because we just couldn't wait. Advent is the celebration of Christmas, but it's about expectation and preparation. We do the same thing at Easter during the Lent season. It's a time of preparation. Almost everything important in our lives requires preparation and expectation, doesn't it? I mean, if you're going to get married, you ask me to do your wedding. I usually meet with a couple for about a year. We have conversations. We talk about the whole process. If you're going to build a house, before you ever start building, you meet with contractors and architects and look at, you know, Pinterest, 1,000 hours, there's a lot of preparation. And if some of y'all plan a vacation, it takes you months, right? You got to get all your reservations, you got to get all your tickets. What all are we going to do? All these things are important to us, and they require preparation. But the problem is that most of us spend our Christmas not in preparation and expectation mode. We spend it in survival mode, don't we? We're just trying to hang on, make it through the holidays. But I want to give all of the parents a little hint. And even some of you grandparents. And I know I have no business giving any grandparents advice because I haven't even been a grandparent for a year. But you don't have to try to create meaning at Christmas. You don't have to try to come up with experiences or moments to create meaning at Christmas. The meaning is already there. The meaning is already there. You just need to focus on that. The part of Christmas that you want to be so important in the life of your family and your children and your in-laws, the part that you want to reside in their memory, you can't create that. You don't need to try to manufacture that. It's the Jesus part. Your children will not remember the elf on the shelf. They probably won't even remember all of the presents and all of that kind of stuff. And hey, we do all that kind of crazy stuff at our house. We celebrate big. I'm not anti any of that fun stuff. At our house, we had the Christmas crawfish. We broke it out this weekend. A couple of years ago, Christmas time, we're having dinner, and I asked my kids, I got 4 kids, what's your favorite Christmas memory? What was your favorite tradition as kids? All the things that we did, all 4 kids, we go around the table. Favorite thing, Christmas Eve worship service at church. The meaning is already there. We don't have to create that. And so we celebrate Advent as a way of helping us as families and individuals, helping us keep the Christmas season between the lines. So that when we get to January, our homes have a lot more light than darkness in them. And our homes have a lot more hope than despair in them. And our homes have a lot more peace than chaos in them. And our homes have a lot more joy than sadness in them. And a lot more love than selfishness. And so today, as we celebrate an Advent, we've already been singing the great Christmas carols. In a little while, we're going to have one of our church families, Clint and Rihanna Logan, and their 2 kids, Lily and Eli, they're going to come up, and they're going to light our second candle today. Today, we're going to focus on hope. Because we live in a world that needs hope, do we not? Absolutely. Hey, do I need to pray? Okay. All right. Hey, let's stand together and let's keep singing.
Let's sing together joy. Joy to the world, the Lord is come. Let earth receive her King. Let prepare him a room, and heaven and
Power in humility.
to the cradle, from cradle to the cross, let heaven and nature sing, this is our King. But the grave couldn't hold him, our God is overcome, let heaven and nature sing, this is our King. Such an important time in our Christian faith as we slow down our lives to focus on you, the hope and the joy and the peace, like Luther was talking about earlier, that can fill our lives when we put our faith in you. Father, we love you. We thank you for that story. Help us to celebrate that every day. Help us to focus on the real reason. Father, as Chaise comes to teach, God, I pray that as he's been preparing, God, that you would just speak through him. We are just your mouthpieces. Father, open our hearts, our ears to receive a word this morning. God, we love you, and it's in your name that we pray. Amen.
Amen. How good was that? Man, what a way to kick off the morning. Absolutely. I'm not gonna lie, like I got chill bumps over there. This is the first time I've ever heard that song, and what a powerful lyric. Can you guys believe that it's December? Like, does anyone else feel like this year just screamed by? Well, it is here, Christmas season. Good morning. My name is Chaise. I am one of the pastors on staff. And again, we are so grateful that you chose to spend your Sunday morning with us this week. It's a time in the life of our church that's exciting. We are in our second week of our Advent season. It's a time where we slow down and we turn our eyes to celebrate God stepping into his world. We celebrate Jesus' birth and what it means for every single person and every part of creation. But I wanted to start out this morning and ask you a question. Have you ever hit the end of hope? Have you ever hit the end of hope? Have you ever been in a time in your life where there just wasn't any hope left? You find yourself in a season where there seemed to be no way to move forward. Maybe for you, it's a job situation, and you keep holding out hope that there is a chance that something could change or that something would change. Maybe for you, it's something more serious. Maybe you've recently gotten a bad diagnosis, or a friend or a family member who is sick, or a loved one who you have prayed for, and you just need God to step in and speak to your circumstances.
No matter how heartbroken you feel, no matter how many tears fill your eyes, it seems like God remains silent. It feels like God refuses to speak into your world and into your darkness. Have you ever found the end of hope? See, today we're going to meet two people who felt the exact same way. And not just them, but the truth of the matter is that the Christmas story, as told in Scripture, is filled with people who felt like they had ran out of hope. People who felt like their prayers had landed on deaf ears. People who felt that God was unaware of them, or even worse, like that God didn't care. From families who were unable to conceive a child for their entire lives and had given up on any thought of having a child on their own, to what seemed to be broken promises and lost trust. God had made promises to his people, but seemingly it seemed as though he had refused to follow through on his word. It had felt hopeless. So what do you do when the world seems dark and God seems silent? When an entire nation who felt as though they had been abandoned by their God in the harshest of times, where they found themselves under the rule of an outside empire, and they hear no word from God, and there seems to be nowhere else to turn. See, when the gospel writers are penning the verses about the birth of Jesus and him coming into the world, they are doing so in a world against this background. It's a world that has not heard from God in over 400 years. It's a world and a nation that felt as if the promises of the coming Messiah were empty words, were with little to no hope of them ever coming to fruition. A Messiah who was promised to free them from foreign rule. A Messiah who would usher into the world the kingdom of God, whose reign and throne would be one of peace and justice. Yet with every passing day, the situation felt more and more hopeless. Before we jump into the book of Luke this morning, I wanted to jump back and look into the book of Malachi, which is the last book in the Old Testament. I wanted to read the last few verses, the last few words from God that the world had heard for 400 years. And this is Malachi 4, verses 1 through 5. Malachi is writing, he says, "For behold, the day is coming, burning like an oven, when all the arrogant and the evildoers will be stubble. The day that is coming shall set them ablaze, says the Lord of hosts, so that it will leave them neither root nor branch." God is going to bring justice to his world. "But for you who fear my name, the Son of Righteousness shall rise with healing in its wings. You'll go out leaping." Listen to this. Listen to this picture. "You will go out leaping like calves from the stall. You shall tread down the wicked, for they will be ashes under the soles of your feet. On the day when I act, says the Lord of hosts, remember the law of my servant Moses, the statutes and rules that I have commanded him at Horeb for all of Israel. Behold, I will send you Elijah, the prophet, before the great and awesome day of the Lord comes, and he will turn the hearts of fathers to their children and the hearts of children to their fathers, lest I come and strike the land with a decree of utter destruction." You see, the Old Testament ends with this incredible promise that there is coming a day when God is going to step in and put his world back in order. A day when righteousness and healing will be at the center of the story. A day when joy will fill his people. And Malachi uses this image of a young calf being let out of his pen the first thing in the morning. What an image. See, this summer, our family, we took the dive and we decided that it was time for the Logan family to become a dog family once again. So we jumped head first. We got our new puppy. We started the journey with our little puppy named Ivy. And she is the cutest little pup that you've seen. But she is a ball of energy. She lives wide open, and one of my favorite things that happens every single morning, I can just wait for it to happen. Every single morning, I hear the crate door open, and then for about 5 or 10 minutes, I hear her running all over the house, jumping on the couch, saying hello to the kids, jumping on the kids. And all morning long, it's like she is so excited because she gets to see everybody for the first time ever. Meanwhile, my girls are screaming, "Ivy, stop! Ivy, stop!" But the joy and the excitement that she has, she is over the top with excitement and joy. See, I think that this is the picture that the prophet is using. That there's going to be a day that the shepherd opens the pen in the morning and the calf just explodes out into the field, consumed with joy and excitement. And he jumps and he kicks in the air. And he says that this is what it's going to be in the hearts of God's people when he enters the scene. That there will be healing. There will be joy. There will be a day when everything begins to be put back together. But then, silence. Not quiet. Silence. How many of us hate silence? How many of you hate the feeling of being in an empty room all alone with your thoughts? How many of you got to play the silent game growing up? Anybody got to play the silent game? Yeah, it's not a game. It took me a little while to figure that out. Let me ask, how many first children do we have? We have any first children, AKA the quiet game winners? You guys, oh, we're playing the game, gonna win. How many middle children do we have? Middle children, we know you guys, yeah. Yeah, we played for about 30 seconds, maybe. Past the two-minute mark, we forgot there was even a game going on. Well, imagine silence that never seemed to end. Silence that not only existed, but seemed to only grow louder. I'm not talking about silence that lasted for a day, not for a month, not for a year, not a decade, not even 100 years, but 400 years. I want you to feel that. Feel what that would have been like. See, the United States has not even existed that long. In fact, you have to go back to about the times that the pilgrims showed up to even have an idea about what 400 years would be. Now think about that silence. Think about that night. How hopeless is that silence? How dark is that night? And this is the backdrop of the birth of Jesus. So we're going to be in Luke chapter 2, verse 22 today. Luke 2, verse 22 today, when Jesus comes on the scene. And when the time came for their purification, according to the law of Moses, they brought him up to Jerusalem to present him to the Lord. As it is written in the law of the Lord, every male who first opens the womb shall be called holy to the Lord, and to offer a sacrifice according to what is said in the law of the Lord, a pair of turtle doves or two young pigeons. Now there was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simeon. And this man was righteous and devout, waiting for the consolation of Israel. And the Holy Spirit was upon him, and it had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not see death before he had seen the Lord's Christ. And he came in the Spirit into the temple, and when the parents brought in the child Jesus to do for him according to the custom of the law, he took him in his arms, and he blessed God. He began to sing. And he said, Lord, now you are letting your servant depart in peace according to your word. For my eyes have seen your salvation that you have prepared in the presence of all people. A light for the revelation to the Gentiles and for the glory to your people, Israel. And his father and mother marveled at what was said about him. And Simeon blessed them, and he said to Mary, his mother, behold, this child is appointed for the fall and rising of many in Israel, and for a sign that is opposed, and a sword will pierce through your own soul also, so that thoughts from many hearts may be revealed. And there was a prophetess, Anna, the daughter of Penuel, of the tribe of Asher. She was advanced in years, having lived with her husband 7 years from when she was a virgin, and then as a widow until she was 84. She did not depart from the temple, worshiping with fasting and prayer night and day. And coming up at that very hour, she began to give thanks to God and to speak of him to all who were waiting for the redemption of Israel. See, Luke introduces us to two figures as Mary and Joseph are presenting Jesus at the temple. Mary and Joseph bring their offering of two doves to offer up as they pass. And as they pass by, Luke tells us that a man named Simeon, filled with the Holy Spirit, begins to prophesy about the young boy. See, Luke tells us a few things that I think are of massive significance. He tells us that this man is a devout and righteous man, that this man prioritized honoring God with his life, and it would seem that the community knew that he was a man of integrity, a man who had influence, as a man who listened to and walked with God. Luke tells us that he was waiting for the consolation of Israel, or the comforting of Israel. That Simeon was a man who was looking forward to the day and was longing for the day that the Messiah would enter the picture. He was looking towards the day when the kingdom would be ushered in and the world would be made right. All of the wrongs would be made right. All of the hurts and pains would be healed. And Luke tells us that the Spirit of God had revealed to him that all of this would happen inside of his lifetime. That before he had passed away, he would see the Christ, that he would see the Messiah of God. Then Luke tells us about another person at the temple. He says that she is a prophetess, and her name is Anna. And he tells us that Anna is older, or I think the phrase that Luke uses is she is advanced in years. He says that she is 84 years old. And she has served in the temple for somewhere around 60 years after she had been widowed by her husband. And Anna had spent her life praying and fasting and looking forward to the arrival of the promised Messiah. We find them both at the temple late in years, waiting. Waiting in silence, just like the rest of Israel. Waiting and wondering, is God going to be faithful to his word? Is God ever going to speak again? Has God forgotten us? Has God abandoned us? Can God be trusted? Remember, this is 400 years of silence, 400 years of hope dwindling and eroding. As every year passes, you can feel the hopelessness growing and the despair growing as the reality of Israel being occupied by Rome seems like there is no way out and all hope is lost. Could imagine with each and every year in Simeon and Anna's heart, just a little bit more doubt creeps in, wondering, is God ever going to step in? Is the promised Messiah coming? Is justice ever coming to our world, or has God moved on? We find them here in this moment where they come face to face with the promises of God. They come face to face with God's promises, and not just promises to them, but a promise God made to all of his people that one day he was sending one to rescue them and restore them and restore all of creation back to its original beauty. In one moment, all of the darkness finds itself wrapped up in hope. Mary and Joseph walk by, and as Simeon sees the boy, the Christ, he begins to prophesy, he begins to sing, and he takes Jesus and he holds him, and he bursts out in worship. And it's like hope rushes in, and Simeon cannot hold it back. He begins to sing. And he sings, and he says that Jesus' arrival brings hope. See, Simeon's song, he sings about God's faithfulness that he himself had seen. Lord, you are letting your servant depart in peace according to your word. God, you have been faithful to what you said to me. God, you have followed through with what you promised to me. My life is full. He sings about God's faithfulness to his people and to the world. You have followed through on your promise of the Messiah, the revelation of hope to the entire world. See, Simeon sees Jesus, and in this moment, he realizes that Jesus is the fulfillment of all of God's promises. So, what does it mean for you and for me? What does the hope of Jesus coming mean for me and for you? What does it look like for us to find hope in Jesus coming? I think first it means that your story is never over. It means that your story is never over. Think about Anna in this story. It could have been easy for her to feel like the best part of her story was in the past. She's 84 years old. It would have been easy for her to believe that her best days were behind her. You can imagine her husband, who you can imagine the love of her life, passing away likely in her early 20s. Her life was lived out serving in the temple. And I'm sure there had to be questions that she had asked. Why did this have to happen to me? Why does this have to be my story? Why does this have to be how the rest of my life is spent? And then, in an instant, Jesus arrives on the scene. The promised one of God, the savior of the world. And Anna becomes not only one of the first people to see Jesus, but she gets to be one of the first people to share with everyone who was walking by that the Messiah has come. The coming of Jesus changed everything. And Anna went from someone who served faithfully, unseen in the shadows, to center stage for welcoming the King of Kings into his world. It means that your story is never over. and it means that the best days are yet to come. See, Jesus arriving on the scene means that the best is still coming, that the story is not over, and Jesus is working to put his world back together. He is righting all of the wrongs. He is bringing justice and healing to his people and to his world. Here's the beautiful part, that it's here for you and for me. That I don't know where you are in your story. I don't know if you're in the middle of your darkness right now, but the hope of the gospel, the hope of Jesus coming into the world, the hope is that the best days are out in front, and they're not just true for Simeon and for Anna, but that Jesus brought that hope to the world, and he brought it to you, and he brought it to me. And he came so that you and I can hold on to the hope that no matter how dark it may feel, no matter how dark it may get, he is the one who is in control. And one day, he is going to not only take away our pain, but he's going to redeem it. He's going to redeem it. That Jesus is going to cause it to serve you and to serve me and to serve his glory. That the promise is that Jesus will take our darkest days and bring from them more beauty and more glory and more light than we could ever imagine. I'm going to say that one more time. The promise and the hope of the gospel is that Jesus will take our darkest days, your darkest days, my darkest days, and bring from them more beauty and more glory and more light than we could ever imagine. So what do we do right now? What do you do right now if we feel like we are in the darkness? What do we do right now if we need hope today? Chaise, what are you supposed to do in the darkness? What do I do if I need hope right now? First, I'd say learn to wait well. Learn to wait well. See, this is one of those spaces that every single one of us struggle with. We live in a what have you done for me lately world, a world where we want answers and we want them now. We wake up in the morning and we pray, and if God hasn't answered us by noon, we find ourselves being frustrated and growing impatient. And think about this story. Think about this story. Think about 400 years of waiting. Not a day, not a week, not a season, but generations of waiting for God to break into the silence. See, I think we get such a great picture of waiting well and what it looks like with Simeon and Anna. I think it speaks volumes of what Luke writes about these two incredible people in the Christmas story. You see, we get waiting wrong so often. See, we think of waiting like we're waiting for our reservations at the restaurant. We think like that's what waiting is. Like, hey, we got here. It's a 45-minute wait. What do? You sit on the bench, create some small talk, and you start buying time. And we think that is what waiting is me just waiting until something happens. But when you read this story, you realize that Simeon and Anna were doing anything but sitting on the sidelines. See, waiting is more like the server at the restaurant. He's waiting on you. He's waiting. What is he doing? The server, they stand back and they wait till you need something. And what are they doing? They're coming and they're serving. See, waiting isn't just sitting on the bench on the sideline. Waiting is when we move and serve others. See, we lean in and we serve and serve God, and they serve the world around them. Waiting on others moves us from the center of the story, and it invites others to experience the hope that we have in the person of Jesus. We learn to wait well. Secondly, we trust when God speaks. We trust when God speaks. See, another space that we can really struggle with. It's not necessarily that we can't or we don't hear the voice of God. Our problem isn't that God isn't speaking often. All too often, our problem is either not believing or second-guessing what God has already spoken to us. That we're willing to listen to any and all and every other voice out in the world except when God speaks. We look around and we feel like we're missing out and we grow impatient. But the story throughout Scripture is that we can trust the faithfulness of God. Learn to trust God. The voice of God in your life. And lastly, learn to preach hope to your own heart. Learn to preach hope to your own heart. See, sometimes we just have to learn how to preach hope to ourselves. See, we hear God speak. We have all of his promises, and all too often in the silence of the night, in the deafening silence of waiting, our heart begins to waver. Our heart begins to doubt. We begin to come up with our own answer to the darkness. But learn to preach to your heart in the darkness, because in the middle of the storm, in the darkest part of the night is when hope does its best work. Hope that your story is not over. That God has more to say about your life and about your story. Preach to your soul that the darkness in our world has already been defeated in the coming of King Jesus. Preach to your soul that even though God hasn't spoken today, it only means that when he does, the glory will only be brighter. Preach to your heart, because if the creator of the universe loves you enough that he comes after you and he makes his dwelling with his people, then there is nothing that can separate you from the hope that is found in Jesus. Preach to your soul, because the hope that one day the Son of Righteousness will shine into the darkness, and forever the night will be gone. What an amazing hope. What an amazing hope in the coming of Jesus to his world. Would you pray with me? God, the story of you coming into your world, it doesn't make sense. God, we have so little to offer. God, you love us so much that you set everything aside in order to step into your world. God, in this season, as we begin to celebrate Advent and your arrival into our space, God, we ask that our hearts and our affection and our attention would be pointed and directed to you and you alone. That God, no matter how dark it may feel right now in our life and in our world and in our circumstances, God, that we can trust that you are in control and that, God, you have spoken. That one day you're going to put it all back together. One day you're going to dry up our tears. One day you're going to take all of that pain and you're going to turn them to good. God, we love you and we thank you. In Jesus' name, amen.